being a teacher and trainer for about two decades and an examiner for almost 10 years, मेरा बहुत दिलचस्प था कि मैं failures पर बात करूँ और आज मुझे ये forum मिला तो मैंने कहा मैं cancers के लिए डॉक्टर आलिया को बुला लिया है, laparoscopy के लिए डॉक्टर सादिया को बुला लिया है, सुंबल को menopause पे बुला लिया है, तो I should be talking about something else. So that is why I chose this topic. I don't know how many of postgraduates are sitting here, लेकिन कभी ना कभी हम भी postgraduates थे. अभी कुछ टीचर हैं, कुछ ट्रेनर हैं, कुछ एग्जामिनर्स हैं. दिस इज द लेटर जो हमें से कोई भी देखना नहीं चाहता, बट बहुत सारों को देखना पड़ता है. नो प्रॉब्लम. बहुत सारों ने देखा और फिर एंड में जब हम जाएंगे तो दूसरा लेटर भी देखा. तो ये जब हम सब लोग अपना क्लिनिकल एग्जाम दे के निकलते हैं या कोई भी थ्योरी का एग्जाम भी होता है, तो क्लिनिकल पे मैं इसलिए फोकस करूंगी बिकॉज द फेलियर रेट्स आर मोर हाई, दे आर हायर इन क्लिनिकल एग्जाम देन इन थ्योरेटिकल एग्जामिनेशन. तो ये लेटर देख के बहुत दुख होता है. नोबडी वांट्स टू गेट दिस लेटर. इस लेटर के बाद क्या होता है? फेलियर सिंड्रोम. आई कॉल इट अ फेलियर सिंड्रोम. एंड फेलियर सिंड्रोम के कॉम्पोनेंट क्या है? ऑल द डॉक्टर्स आर क्रीम ऑफ द नेशन. सबने सब जगह पे बड़ी अच्छी अच्छी मेडल्स जीते होते हैं, पोजीशन होल्डर रहे होते हैं, और जब एक फेलियर देखने को मिलता है तो सबसे पहले तो कहते हैं मैं तो कभी फेल नहीं हुआ, मैंने तो हमेशा टॉप किया है, मैं तो हमेशा फर्स्ट अटेम्प्ट में निकला हूँ. तो वो एक्सेप्ट करने में प्रॉब्लम होती है. सो द फर्स्ट सिम्टम इज डिनायल, देन एंगर. गुस्सा किस किस पे आता है? कभी अपने ऊपर आता है, अपने ऊपर वैसे आखिर में आता है, टीचर्स पे, ट्रेनर्स पे, इंस्टीट्यूशन पे, फैमिली पे, इसने ये नहीं किया, उसने वो नहीं किया, एंड प्रॉबेबली दे ऑल डू कॉन्ट्रीब्यूट टू सम एक्सटेंट. लो सेल्फ एस्टीम, कॉन्फिडेंस लूज कर बैठते हैं, अपनी कैपेबिलिटीज में डाउट होने लगता है जो होना नहीं चाहिए. सुसाइडल थॉट्स. आई हैव सीन पीपल, आई हैव हर्ड पीपल ये कहते हुए कि अब तो मैंने, जब हम लोग पोस्ट ग्रेजुएट थे, हमारे जो पीयर्स थे, और जब हम टीचर बन गए, हम ट्रेनर बन गए, तो पीपल नो ऑफन टॉक अबाउट अटेम्प्टिंग सुइसाइड एंड चेंजिंग देयर कैरियर पाथ एज वेल. एनवी भी करते हैं, जो पास हो गए उनको एनवी करते हैं. ब्लेम गेम भी होती है. ये कब होता है? जब शादीशुदा हो और इन लॉस के साथ रह रहे हैं. तो आई थिंक ये जो सिंड्रोम है, दिस इज क्वाइट प्रिवेंटेबल. कैसे प्रिवेंट कर सकते हैं? उसके बाद में आ जाते हैं. मैं जब अपने पोस्ट ग्रेजुएट्स के साथ बैठती हूँ, जब वो फेल होके आते हैं, जिस दिन एग्जाम होता है तो हम सब लोग मुंतजिर होते हैं कि एक फोन कॉल आएगी और हमारा ट्रेनी हमें बताएगा कि आई गॉट थ्रू. वो एक ऐसा मोमेंट होता है जो एक ट्रेनी तो नहीं समझ सकता कि हाउ मच अ ट्रेनर बिकम्स हैप्पी व्हेन अ ट्रेनी गेट्स थ्रू द एग्जामिनेशन. लेकिन जब आप लोग जो पोस्ट ग्रेजुएट्स हैं, वो हमारी पोजिशन में आएंगे, दे विल रियलाइज द जॉय ऑफ सक्सेस जो हम शेयर करते हैं अपने ट्रेनी की सक्सेस पे. जो हमें खुशी होती है वो आई जस्ट कैन नॉट एक्सप्रेस इन वर्ड्स. और ऐसा भी होता है कि जो फेलियर्स के डेस्परेट टाइम्स होते हैं वो भी हम उनके साथ शेयर करते हैं. हम उदास होते हैं, हम परेशान होते हैं कि हमारा ट्रेनी क्यों फेल हुआ. लेकिन ट्रेनी क्या कहता है? ट्रेनी कहता है कि मैडम मैं तो इसलिए फेल हो गई कि मेरा बच्चा बीमार हो गया था एग्जाम से जस्ट पहले. और डू यू थिंक दिस इज द रीजन टू जस्टिफाई अ फेलियर? आई डोंट थिंक सो दैट अ फ्यू डेज और अ मंथ शुड रियली मैटर. प्री एग्जाम मंथ उसकी कोई हैसियत नहीं है आपके चार साल की ट्रेनिंग में. कोई कहता है जी आई वॉज अनलकी टू गेट एन अनकॉपरेटिव पेशेंट इन द एग्जाम. सो डू वी नॉट गेट अनकॉपरेटिव पेशेंट इन आर क्लिनिक? शुडंट वी लर्न टू हैंडल देम एंड टू एक्सट्रैक्ट द रेलिवेंट इन्फॉर्मेशन ड्यूरिंग आर ट्रेनिंग पीरियड? जब आपका ट्रेनिंग पीरियड चल रहा है एंड यू आर वर्किंग अंडर समबडी सुपरविजन, यू कैन ऑलवेज सीक गाइडेंस एंड हेल्प कि जी डिफिकल्ट पेशेंट को मुझे हैंडल कैसे करना था. आई रन आउट ऑफ टाइम इन पेशेंट इनकाउंटर. दिस इज अ वेरी कॉमन प्रॉब्लम कि टाइम मैनेज नहीं कर पाए. अगेन आई थिंक दिस इज समथिंग विच इज टू बी एड्रेस्ड बाय द ट्रेनर्स एंड बाय द ट्रेनीज टुगेदर. टॉक स्टेशन कोई ऐसा आ गया जिसमें हम कभी ट्रेन नहीं हुए, हमारे अस्पताल में लैप्रोस्कोप नहीं है, हमारे अस्पताल में हिस्ट्रोस्कोप नहीं है, उसके ऊपर स्टेशन क्यों बना दिया. सो फॉर द लास्ट डेकेड और सो हम एक कल्चरल चेंज देख रहे हैं. वो चेंज ये है कि वर्कशॉप्स, सिंपोजियम, कॉन्फ्रेंसेस, उसके अंदर तकरीबन उनके कॉम्पोनेंट्स में एवरीथिंग इज इंक्लूडेड. सो इट्स द ड्यूटी ऑफ द ट्रेनी टू गो एंड अटेंड एंड गेट वेल वर्स्ड विद दोज कॉम्पिटेंसीज जो उसके अपने इंस्टीट्यूशन में नहीं प्रैक्टिस. लास्ट बट नॉट लीस्ट डॉक्टर सम्या शुजा वाज लाइक एंड शी इज टू स्टिंजी अबाउट द बेसिक्स. सो वेयर आर वी लैगिंग? बेसिक नॉलेज, बेसिक कॉन्सेप्ट्स. इफ द बेसिक्स आर स्ट्रांग यू कैन बिल्ड अप something huge on that base. But if the base is weak, then you just cannot do anything about that. So while somebody is being tested for the depth in knowledge, this is where people fail. People, they just cannot go into the depth of the knowledge. So basics pe strength apni build karni chahiye. अपने तौर पे तो मैं सोचती थी कि फेलियर क्यों होते हैं, कैसे होते हैं. तो वन डे आई जस्ट गूगल कि व्हाट आर द रीजंस ऑफ फेलियर. तो आई वाज रियली सरप्राइज टू सी अ फ्यू रिसर्च पेपर्स पब्लिश्ड ऑन फेलियर्स एंड आई केम टू नो दैट फेलियर इज नॉट जस्ट एंडेमिक टू द पाकिस्तानी सिस्टम ऑफ एग्जामिनेशन. यूके का सिस्टम भी इसी डिजीज के साथ इससे अफेक्टेड है. So these few papers that you find on the web, they talk about, they conclude by saying that it is not only the trainer and the trainee who are responsible for the failures. There are the causes are multidirectional. So एक चीज जो उनके अंदर बहुत अच्छे तरीके से एड्रेस हुई है वो ये कि एक क्वेश्चन दिन में आता शुड बी रियली गो थ्रू एग्जाम्स. उसके बगैर नहीं काम चल सकता. होने चाहिए एग्जाम चाहिए नहीं होने चाहिए? होने चाहिए नहीं होने चाहिए? होने चाहिए. क्यों होने चाहिए? सो हियर इज द आंसर. फंक्शन है कुछ एग्जाम्स है. वो फंक्शन क्या है? यू हैव टू सेटिस्फाई योर पब्लिक. क्या सेटिस्फेक्शन उनको चाहिए कि उनके प्रैक्टिशनर्स जो हैं उनके लिए कोई मिनिमम लेवल ऑफ कॉम्पिटेंस. सो इट इज द लाइसेंसिंग फंक्शन दैट एग्जाम्स सर्व टू सेटिस्फाई द यूनिवर्सिटीज दैट इट्स ग्रेजुएट्स आर एकेडेमिकली फिट टू कैरी ऑन द सर्विस दे आर सपोज टू. सो इट्स द ग्रेजुएटिंग फंक्शन टू डिस्क्रिमिनेट बिटवीन द बेस्ट गुड एंड द पुअर. द रैंकिंग फंक्शन to encourage the students to work, the motivating function, to assist the students in putting together the materials that have been acquired separately, the integrating function, to provide feedback to the students and staff on the performance of students and teachers, the informative function. So exam ki importance ko to hum deny nahi kar sakte. Aur waise bhi mera khayal hai ki agar exams nikal gaye to shayad hum jo thoda bahut padhte likhte hain wo bhi padhna chhod dein. So we need to come up to a level where we can satisfy our examiners. These are the factors that have been identified by experts which are playing their roles in the failures. Lack of health infrastructure, postgraduate training quality, training in medical colleges and examination system. So I will not be talking of any of these today because they all are beyond my control. However, we do expect a change. Jaise subah ke plenary session mein hum change ki baat humne suni, last evening inaugural session mein bhi change ki baat humne suni. So jab se maine Indus Hospital join kiya hai aur mujhe lagta hai कि बाकी चीजें चेंज होती हैं तो मेरा अपना भी यकीन पक्का हो गया कि यस चेंज आ सकता है. सो इंशाल्लाह दैट चेंज विल कम इन पाकिस्तान एज वेल, लेकिन दैट इज गोइंग टू बी अ स्लो एंड ग्रेजुअल प्रोसेस. तो मे बी वो जो इस वक्त ट्रेनीज हैं उनकी लाइफ टाइम में ना हो सके, या जब तक कोई एग्जाम के प्रोसेस में है उस वक्त ना हो सके. तो फिर देयर शुड बी द फोकस. इन्वेस्टमेंट क्या होती है? इन्वेस्टमेंट आप किसी चीज को, इसको हम कैपिटल की फॉर्म में लेते हैं कि हम लोग अपनी कोई रकम पे इन्वेस्ट करते हैं और हमें ये उम्मीद होती है और ख्वाहिश होती है कि कल हमें ये मल्टीप्लाई होकर मिलेगी. हम कभी बिजनेस में इन्वेस्ट करते हैं, स्टॉक्स में इन्वेस्ट करते हैं. सो देर आर सो मेनी फॉर्म्स ऑफ इन्वेस्टमेंट, बट परहैप्स द बिगेस्ट इन्वेस्टमेंट ऑफ अ पोस्ट ग्रेजुएट्स लाइफ इज द ट्रेनिंग पीरियड. जब इन्वेस्टमेंट की जाती है तो रैंडमली तो कोई इन्वेस्टमेंट नहीं कर देता. इन्वेस्टमेंट करने से पहले यू नीड थॉरो रिसर्च, यू नीड टू हैव होल्डिंग पावर एंड यू नीड टू सेल द इन्वेस्टमेंट टाइमली. एक इन्वेस्टमेंट वो है जो आपने आप स्टॉक्स में इन्वेस्ट करना चाहते हैं, आपने सारी रिसर्च की कि कहाँ इन्वेस्टमेंट करूं तो मुझे सबसे ज्यादा रिटर्न मिलेंगे. ऐसा नहीं है कि अखबार में वो किसी ने इश्तहार दे दिया कि कोई डबल शाह काम कर रहा है और आप जाके उसको पैसे पकड़ाते और कहते हैं ये डबल करके मुझे दे देगा. दैट इज अ नॉनसेंस फॉर्म ऑफ इन्वेस्टमेंट. सो वी ऑल बीइंग एजुकेटेड पीपल वी शुड नो दैट इन्वेस्टमेंट रिसर्च इन द फॉर्म ऑफ फाइंडिंग अ गुड इंस्टीट्यूशन, ट्राइंग टू गेट अ रिलेशनशिप with a good supervisor, having a dialogue with the family ki ji this is the pursuit I am going to take up. So aapke sath kitne log hain, family mein kitne log hain jo committed hain to take you through the task of training. So ye sara homework hoga before you embark on training. So probably is waqt jo trainees baithe hain wo apni training shuru kar chuke hain, but it's never too late. You can do this exercise now. You can have a look at your investment. You can have a dialogue now and then move on. So what is the holding power? Ek capital invest karne ke baad aapko patience chahiye hota hai, aapko wait karna padta hai, aapko us waqt ka intezar karna padta hai jo jab wo aapko kuch pay back karne ke liye wo investment ready hai. That is the time when you can sell. So a holding power. अब हम इस मॉडल को एक पोस्ट ग्रेजुएट ट्रेनिंग में कैसे अप्लाई कर सकते हैं? पोस्ट ग्रेजुएट ट्रेनिंग में हम इस तरह अप्लाई कर सकते हैं कि आप जिस डील के साथ पोस्ट ग्रेजुएट ट्रेनिंग में एंटर हो प्लीज उस डील को कहीं डाई आउट ना होने दें. दिस इज नॉट समथिंग विच इज नॉट इम्पॉसिबल, दिस इज वेरी मच पॉसिबल. और इम्पॉसिबल को पॉसिबल कैसे बनाया जाता है? विद योर एफर्ट, रिपीटेड डायलॉग विद योर फैमिली, अपनी प्रायोरिटीज को रीएडजस्ट करना होगा कि ये जो टास्क मैंने लिया है मैं इसको कैसे पूरा करूं. एंड यू शुड वर्क टू लर्न नॉट टू गेट थ्रू द एग्जाम. इफ द प्राइमरी ऑब्जेक्टिव चेंजेस द सेकेंडरी ऑब्जेक्टिव बिकम सो ईजी टू अचीव. द सेकेंडरी ऑब्जेक्टिव शुड बी गेटिंग थ्रू द एग्जामिनेशन एंड द प्राइमरी ऑब्जेक्टिव शुड बी टू लर्न and be a good doctor. So hold on to whatever you have taken up and wait for the time till you can sell your product. Now the selling time is when you are really prepared for your exam. We are all the time talking of time nahi mila, ye nahi kar sake, wo nahi kar sake, but I think responsibility lies with us the individuals कि हम अपने टाइम को मैनेज करना सीख लें. टाइम मैनेजमेंट आपको सिर्फ एग्जाम के लिए नहीं, अपनी तमाम प्रैक्टिकल लाइफ में काम आती है. बहुत सारी ऐसे टाइम हमारी जिंदगी में आते हैं व्हेन वी हैव टू मेनी थिंग्स इन आवर प्लेट, वी कैन नॉट ईट ऑल ऑफ दैट. सो वी जस्ट पिक एंड चूज एंड ट्राई टू टेक द हेल्दियर वन. So you need to drop out the unhealthy activities, the activities which are not going to pay you in any form. And while you are being trained, करियर के दौरान आपको ये सोचना होगा कि मैं जो स्किल्स अचीव कर रहा हूँ मैंने उसको बेहतर से बेहतर कैसे करना है। गाइनी ऑप्स के हवाले से बात करूंगी कि बहुत सारे सिजेरियन कर लेना या बहुत सारे सर्जिकल प्रोसीजर्स कर लेना और उनकी बेसिक्स जाने बगैर, तो आई थिंक उससे कहीं अच्छा है कि आप कम प्रोसीजर्स करें लेकिन उनको सही तरीके से सीखें। सो पीपल हु हैव डन लेस नंबर ऑफ सर्जरीज विद अ क्लियर कॉन्सेप्ट विद अ क्लियर अंडरस्टैंडिंग दे आर बेटर सर्जन देन दोज हु डू प्लेंटी ऑफ सर्जिकल प्रोसीजर्स लेकिन वो प्रोसीजर्स ना उनके अपने समझ में आए होते हैं तो ना किसी और की समझ में आए। यू शुड एम एट डिलीवरिंग द बेस्ट टू योर पेशेंट। अगर मैं आज पेशेंट बनूं तो मेरा दिल करेगा कि शहर का बेहतरीन सर्जन मेरा काम करे। सो आप सबका एम ये होना चाहिए एक एक टिश्यू एक एक लेयर एक एक लव्स एक एक दिन एक एक पेशेंट जो आपके साथ जिसका इंटरेक्शन डेली होता है उसको समझें उस पर फोकस करें। और एक जो चीज मैंने ड्यूरिंग प्लानिंग देखी है कि हम जल्दी में होते हैं। अ डॉक्टर कैन नॉट बी इन अ हरी, अ डॉक्टर जस्ट कैन नॉट बी इन अ हरी। उसको अपना काम उतने ही सुकून से करना है। जब आप धीरे धीरे फोर इयर्स की ट्रेनिंग अपनी करते रहते हैं अपनी पढ़ाई साथ चलाते हैं अपनी स्किल्स को पॉलिश करते रहते हैं तो ये हो नहीं सकता कि एग्जाम में आप फेल हो जाए। मे बी वंस कोई लक ने काम नहीं किया तो आप ड्रॉप आउट हो गए बट दिस वुड नॉट बी अ केस ऑफ रिपीटिंग फेलियर। सो फेलिंग वंस और ट्वाइस डजंट मैटर बट समबडी हु फेल 10 टाइम्स 12 टाइम्स 13 टाइम्स वो वाकई सोचने की बात है कि कहीं पे कोई गड़बड़ है। और ऐसे लोगों को देख के उनका दिल तो परेशान होता ही है मैं उनसे ज्यादा दुखी होती हूँ बिकॉज देयर लाइफ बिकम्स मिजरेबल। सो हियर इज अ रेसिपी फॉर दोज हु हैव फेस्ड रिपीटेड फेलियर्स। आई थिंक दैट इज द टाइम व्हेन यू शुड ट्राई टू आइडेंटिफाई योर वीकनेस। यू नीड टू सिट विद योर सुपरवाइजर बिकॉज सुपरवाइजर इज द बेस्ट पर्सन हु नोज यू। वो आपकी वीकनेसेस और स्ट्रेंथ्स को जानता होता है। पीपल हैव कम टू मी के जी हम दूसरे शहर से आए हैं कि आप हमें बता दें कि कैसे हम आगे बढ़ सकते हैं बट आई डोंट नो दैट मैं कैसे बता सकती हूँ। सो सुपरवाइजर के पास ऐसे भी नहीं जाना कि ये भी सिखा दे तो वो भी सिखा दे। आपकी ट्रेनिंग हो चुकी है उसके पास टाइम नहीं है लेकिन अपनी वीकनेसेस को आइडेंटिफाई करने के लिए जरूर सुपरवाइजर के पास जाए। ब्रूस ली ने कहा कि आई फियर द मैन आई डू नॉट फियर द मैन हु हैज प्रैक्टिस्ड 10,000 किक्स बट आई डू फियर द मैन हु हैज प्रैक्टिस्ड 1 kick 10,000 टाइम्स। सो आई जस्ट वॉन्ट टू से दैट यू नीड प्रैक्टिस टू बिकम अचीव परफेक्शन एंड बींग डॉक्टर्स हमारे पास वी हैव टू प्रैक्टिस 10,000 किक्स 10,000 टाइम्स बिकॉज आप एक चीज के साथ चल नहीं सकते। सो हैविंग सेड दैट आई एम कॉन्फिडेंट दैट वन डे यू विल रिसीव दिस लेटर। डोंट फॉरगेट टू शेयर विद मी दिस इज माय डे। थैंक यू वेरी मच एंड प्रिपेयर योरसेल्फ फॉर द नेक्स्ट।
Our next speaker is Dr. Sumbal Suhail. Dr. Sumbal Suhail, as you all know, is the Associate Professor of Obstetrics and Gynecology, Karachi Medical and Dental College, General Secretary, Pakistan Menopause Society, Chairperson, Research and Education, South Asian Federation of Menopause, Pakistan Representative for Southeast Asian Society of Menopause. I will request Dr. Sumbal Suhail to come on the stage and share with us about the update on the
I was asked to give a talk on menopause, but I see very a lot of young girls over here. Probably, I don't know, we belong to that class where we would be needing this treatment, but you are there to listen for the future generations. So menopause, what all we want to know about menopause? what is menopause? Menopause is the permanent cessation of menstruation that results from the loss of ovarian function. And worldwide, the age is usually from 45 to 55 years with an average of 50.7. But studies being done in the Asian and the South Asian countries found that our women become menopause at a much earlier age, and that is around about 47 years. And there are certain women who become menopause at a later stage, around about 55 years, so that is known as late menopause. In Pakistan, the age of women is now 67.4 years, so our women are living for a longer period of time. And this was a study done in Sydney where they found that women now live a third of their lives after menopause, so we need to start thinking about them. This is some of the nice faces of menopausal ladies from different parts of Pakistan, so I just wanted to give you, they're all happy looking women. Then you have the induced or the surgical menopause, which is cessation of menstruation that follows after surgical removal of both the ovaries or because of chemotherapy, radiation, or treatment with GnRH analogs. What is perimenopause? Perimenopause is the period beginning with the first clinical, biological, and endocrinological features that the menopause is soon going to appear, associated with vasomotor symptoms and cyclical irregularity. It can occur a year or two before the actual menopause sets in. Now, if you want to diagnose in women, you need to have at least 12 months of menopause before you label a patient that she is now menopause. But for those who are less than 50 years, we can do levels of follicle stimulating hormone that need to be more than 30 international units. What are the consequences of menopause? Why are we concerned about it? Vasomotor symptoms. Studies done again in the Asian countries found that our women usually do not complain of vasomotor symptoms. The problem associated with our women is mostly body aches and pains. Then you have the psychological symptoms, sexual dysfunction, joint and muscle pain, mood swings, sleep disturbance, osteoporosis, cardiovascular disease, urogenital atrophy, and sexual dysfunction. Now, what is the underlying cause of this sexual dysfunction? Probably our women do not complain much about sexual dysfunction, considered more like a taboo. But in the West, even women at 90 years are sexually active. But the underlying problem for female sexual dysfunctions are usually multifactorial. Estrogen deficiency can lead to vaginal dryness and dyspareunia. Other non-hormonal factors could be like conflict between the partners, insomnia, inadequate stimulation, stresses of life, which all can lead to sexual dysfunction. Psychological symptoms are there. The women may be depressed, anxiety, irritable, which probably see all in ourselves also. Don't you think we all women are across menopause? We do become sometimes irritable, and our children tell us, Amma, I think you have become menopausal, that is why you are behaving like this. And a general population study suggests that most women do not experience major mood changes during menopause, though it is attributed to menopause. Osteoporosis affects 1 in 3 women, and the risk factors include family history of fracture, low BMI, early menopause, cigarette smoking, alcohol not related to our society, sedentary lifestyles, use of steroids, and hyperthyroidism. The common sites for osteoporotic fractures are the lower end of the radius, and the proximal femur, and the vertebra. There's definitely some weight gain occurring after menopause. Midlife weight gain usually occurs at the rate of 0.5 kg per year. So every woman is gaining about 0.5 kg per year. And this increase in waist circumference and central abdominal fat may be reduced by taking hormone therapy, but this all can lead to increased cardiovascular disease, dyslipidemia, and what is known as metabolic syndrome. Cardiovascular disease, again, a lot of our women are suffering from cardiovascular diseases, and it is a number one killer of women after the age of 50. The risk factors are, again, myocardial infarction, smoking, depression, and stresses of life. Incidence of this stroke increases with age, more common after the age of 60. Again, risk factors are hypertension, smoke, diabetes, hyperlipidemia, and obesity. This was a study done in 2006, a very famous study known as the Nurses' Health Study. And what they suggested that it is the timing of the hormone initiation which is very important if you are starting hormone therapy to these women. Because if you are giving it at an earlier age, it might have a beneficial effect on these women, and it reduces the risk of coronary artery disease by 10%. However, this benefit effect was not observed in women who initiated the therapy after 10 years of menopause. Urogenital atrophy, you all know that the female genital tract and the lower urinary tract, they share a very common embryological origin, and they all have got estrogen receptors in them. The estrogen and progesterone receptors are present in the vagina, the urethra, the bladder, and the pelvic floor musculature. And estrogen deficiency causes atrophic changes in the urogenital tract, and it is associated with urinary symptoms and may coexist with symptoms of vaginal atrophy. What are the treatment options? Very important thing is we have to make our women very much aware about it. The life does not end after you are 50 years old. We need to educate our women. I have to ask them to make certain lifestyle changes, because whenever you ask these women, what are they doing? They're not doing anything. They're not doing any constructive. I mean, apart from us ladies who are involved in teaching and were either involved in teaching or are doctors, you see them to be leading a very sedentary lifestyle. So we need to create an awareness amongst them. Educate our ladies. Try to make lifestyle changes, healthy diet, exercise, and of course reduction of stress. And then the least thing is the menopausal hormone therapy. Now these are available in different regimes. You can have combined regimes that have more estrogen and progesterone in women who do have a uterus. Then estrogen alone in those women who do not have a uterus. Then we have creams and pessaries where you just need it for local application. Then we have the selective estrogen receptor modulators for women who cannot use simple estrogens. Nowadays, the latest ones are the estrogens and the bezodoxin receptors, known as the selective tissue estrogen complexes, which are said to be more effective for those women who probably have a high risk for breast cancers. And then you have the selective estrogen progesterone and the androgen receptor modulators, example being tipiline. Now we have the natural estrogens, and then we are known as the and then we have the synthetic ones. So 17 beta estradiol, the estron, the estriol, which are chemically synthesized from soya beans or yams, are the natural hormones. And the conjugated equine estrogen, and consisting primarily of the estron sulfate, it is produced from the female horse urine. So this is the synthetic. Then we have the progesterogens, which are high in androgenic potency. Again, they are the natural ones, and then they are the man-made ones. So those who are man-made are known as progestrogens or progestins. They have marked adverse effect on the lipoproteins, and they negate the beneficial effect sometimes of the estrogen. And the examples are 19 norprogestrogen, norgestrel, and norethisterone. And then there are those who have got moderate androgenic potency. Examples are the medroxyprogesterone acetate. Those we have no androgenic potency are the diprogesterone and the micronized progesterone. So these, they are usually come under the natural ones. What are the routes of administration? It can be given orally, which is most widely used worldwide. You have the transdermal patches. For those women who cannot take orally, you have the effective transdermal containing the natural estrogens. Again, you have the intravaginal pessaries, where you again need for the local application, and then you have the subcutaneous implants also available, but not very popular. The prescribing regime says that estrogen therapy may be given cyclical, administered for the first 21 days of the cycle, or it can be given continuously for a period of 3 months, and then you can add up a progesterone in the last 12 to 13 days, in the last 3 months, you're giving it for 3 months, right? So you give estrogen for the first 3 months, and in the last part of the 3 months, you add up a progesterone. So all progesterones can be given sequentially, and they are given cyclically, and you add up for every cycle, you add up in the last 12 to 14 days. Okay, you get it? Now this sequential therapy that you are giving, in which you are adding progesterones in the last 10 to 14 days of the cycle, it mimics the normal menstrual cycle, and the women tends to have regular monthly periods. The periods are often lighter, And this is very much appropriate regime to be given for those women who are complaining of irregular cycle in the perimenopausal period. Well, the continuous combined regime is mostly for those women who do not want to bleed cyclically, who are postmenopausal. Now, what are these vasomotor symptoms that everybody is talking about? Vasomotor symptoms. These are the hot flushes and night sweats which are experienced by as many as 85% of the women around menopause. Usually these last for 5 years. In some women, they may even last for 5 to 7 years. And they causes what? Decrease the quality of life by reducing sleep, insomnia, difficult concentrating, reducing the quality of life. And one a very important study, which was a Swan study done, this linked vasomotor symptoms to cardiovascular, bone, and cognitive risk. So all these women who have vasomotor symptoms have got increased risk of having all these problems. Now, hormone replacement therapy is very, very effective in treating hot flashes, and improvement is usually seen within 4 weeks, with a maximum effect achieved within 3 months. But this treatment should be continued at least for a period of five years, because if you stop in between, 50% of the women start complaining of vasomotor symptoms again. Like I said, lowest dose of the conjugated equine estrogen is 0.3 milligram. Among the natural estradiol, it is 0.5 milligram. Taken for 6 to 8 weeks will provide you with adequate relief. Symptoms, they do return after stopping. However, there is no consensus whether stopping or tapering is preferable, especially after the age of 60 years. That has to be consulted with the physician, whether the physician or the patient itself, they want to stop the treatment or they want to continue. Then you have the urinogenital symptoms and sexuality, vaginal dryness, like I've said before, superficial dyspareunia, frequency and urgency. They all respond well to the local application of estrogens. And you should all know that it's not need an add-back progesterone if you're using it for a vaginal cream. Urinary incontinence is much improved, however, urinary infections are not improved, and they even may become sometimes worse. Treatment is usually long-term, if not lifelong-term, as I've said earlier, synthetic estrogens or conjugated equines should be absorbed. In those women where estrogens are relatively contraindicated, they should be avoided. So you try to use simple estrogens which can be applied vaginally. So nowadays you have the low-dose natural estrogens in the form of creams and pessaries. Nowadays non-estrogen therapies like Osmifen and intravaginal dehydroepiandrosterone sulfate are available, and they are recommended for those women who cannot take oral. Now, prevention or treatment of osteoporosis. This again needs to be continued for life, and BMD falls when treatment is stopped. However, other options should be discussed with the patient if the patient cannot take long-term menopausal therapies. So now, osteoporosis, what does the treatment do? It prevents bone loss by inhibition of both osteoclast-driven resorption and causes a reduced rate bone remodeling. It reduces the risk of spine, hip, and other osteoporotic fractures. This also needs lifelong treatment to be effective in preventing fractures. It is not recommended, however, as a first-line treatment because the risks are more than the benefits. And again, the standard dose is 0.6 to 5 milligram of conjugated equine estradiol of 1.1 to 2 milligram and transdermal patches of 25 to 50 microgram. However, you should know that the bone protection dissipates rapidly after stopping the hormone therapy. And discontinuation leads to rapidly dissipating the benefit effect, but no rebound in fracture risk is increased. Okay, the fracture risk will stay there, it is not increased. This is one of the studies which were done in Mauritius, a little old slide, which is telling us about how the beneficial effect on the hormone therapy is done on the female neck and the trochanteric, how there is improvement in the bone mineral density. There are other treatment available also, like the bisphosphonates, which reduces both the vertebral and the non-vertebral fractures. Among the latest one is the zoledronic acid, which is 5 milligram given in the form of an IV infusion. Then you have the SERM, selective estrogen receptor modulators. They also reduce the fractures. However, they do not treat vasomotor symptoms and even cause transient side effects such as hot flushes. So it is not recommended for those women who also have vasomotor symptoms. And it has got an equal propensity for producing thrombosis. The other treatment available are calcitriol, the calcium and the vitamin D supplements which can be given to these women. Colorectal cancer, which is one of the leading cancer found in women, the incidence increases with age, reduces the hormone therapy, does reduce the risk of colorectal cancer by about one-third, and this benefit persists for up to 4 years of continuing with the treatment. However, it should not solely be used for the prevention of colorectal cancer. Now, breast cancer. The association between hormone therapy and breast cancer is very much controversial. The breast cancer risk should be evaluated before prescribing hormone therapy. Now, the risk of breast cancer is dependent on the regime that you are giving. The greatest risk is with the combined estrogen progestogens. Estrogen alone, however, decreases the risk. So in those women who do not have a uterus, you can prescribe them, and the risk for breast cancer is reduced. So the risk of breast cancer is minimal after 5 years of usage. Less than 1% per 1,000 women a year is the risk. What does it do? It increases the breast density, and it causes increase in the mammography evaluation and complicates the screening. And this was a study called the WHI study. They found that the risk in the estrogen alone group was, however, 23% lower than in the placebo group. Annual mammogram should be proposed in case of increased breast density. So I just tell you that tibulin is not associated with an adverse effect on mammographic density, and there's lower risk with micronized progesterone over the natural progesterone, diprogesterone. However, lack of safety data we do not have any data available right now regarding use of hormone replacement therapy in those patients who are breast cancer survivors. I will just skip this. Let's come to the endometrial cancer. You all know that unopposed estrogen therapy increases the risk of endometrial cancer, and the risk is still increased for 5 years or more even after discontinuation of the therapy. Addition of progestogen reduces this risk, but not completely, especially with sequential progestogen, especially if they're used for more than 5 years. And if a woman is coming to you with a history of bleeding in between, the patient needs to be evaluated. Tamoxifen has a small but definite association with endometrial hyperplasia, and the newer drugs which are available, known as bezidoxifen, in the doses of 30 to 40 milligrams reduces endometrial thickness, and it can even be given for the vulvovaginal atrophy. Thromboembolism, of course, there is the risk is highest in the first year of its use. Cardiovascular disease, no evidence shows that estradiol-based HRTs increase. They do not increase the blood pressure. Depending upon the dyslipidemia, depending upon the type of HRT you are using, of course, venous thromboembolism is a relative contraindication. Cervical cancer has not found any increased risk in cervical cancer as a causative agent. Even for ovarian cancer, no association has been found. Diabetes seems to be improved. Thyroid diseases need to be evaluated because it can increase the concentration of thyroxine globally. Conclusion, it's very important that different hormone-based therapies are there. Even within the same class, they may have different effect on the target organs. Lowest effective dose should be used and consistent. The aim should be that you should be able to achieve the treatment goals and provide benefit to the patient and minimizing the side effects. Formulation dose consideration for long-term use include persistent. If the patient has got persistent vasomotor symptoms, quality of life issues, and prevention of osteoporosis, the patient's it should be discussed with the patient whether she wants to have it beyond 60 years of age. Safety profile is most preferable when it is initiated in women younger than 60 years of age or within 10 years of menopause. So immediately started as soon as the patient has stopped having a period for at least 1 year. However, older women more than 60 years need to be individualized and with shared decision making and periodic evaluation to determine the women's benefit profile. Conclusion, need not be routinely discontinued. However, it is very important that you review the comorbidities and periodic trials of lowering or discontinuing or changing to potentially safer drugs should be used. Thank you. Thank you very much. I'm short of time. I had a little talk on premature ovarian insufficiency, also may be probably sometimes.
Thank you, Dr. Sumbul, for such an informative talk. Our next speaker is Dr. Sadia Ismail. She is Professor of Obs and Gyne, Consultant OPG by OMI Hospital, Member NCMNH, Member of JPMA Editorial Board, Member of Representative Committee of Royal College of Obs and Gyne for Pakistan. And the topic for her discussion is role of laparoscopy in the infertility. I will request Dr. Sadia to come.
Assalamu alaikum, and thank you for inviting me, Dr. Farabani, Dr. Samia. And her talk was very interesting, especially because the last time I was associated with Samia was when I was a program director for postgraduate trainees in gyne-ons at Liaquat National Hospital. And she's one of the people who sensitized me to the problems of the postgraduates. So they all used to come and cry to me about their issues, and it got made me think a lot and try to reform things, and enough to write an editorial about the plight of the postgraduates in Pakistan. So I'm very happy that she's concerned about their failures. And I wrote that editorial in, I think it was around the 2000, it was published in JPMA. And one of the reasons that I identify that trainers, we need to look at ourselves also. And we are very fond of becoming examiners, yet we do not want to spend time training our postgraduates. And we need to use them, we use them as horses without providing them with training. That same postgraduate is incompetent to do a hysterectomy on a cesarean in the daytime when the seniors are there, and suddenly at 2 in the morning is competent enough to do a cesarean hysterectomy. So this is not in one institution, this is prevalent all over Pakistan, and we really need to address it. One of my colleagues, ENT colleagues, who happened to be my class fellow and professor of ENT, he read that editorial and he said, if I just change gynae to ENT in this editorial, it applies to ENT as well. And so did my surgical colleagues. So we really need to we need to address this and improve it, and I'm so glad that you're talking about it. So I'll come to the other thing that is an issue. I mean, we all like to do more advanced surgeries, and laparoscopic surgery is really something you should be doing as an postgraduate before your licensing exam of getting your FCPS or MRCOG. You should certainly be competent enough to do a diagnostic laparoscopy on level 1 and 2, which includes ectopic and simple ovarian cysts and stuff like that. But unfortunately, our graduates don't even get trained in conventional surgery. So you really should be going on to this after you're very good at conventional surgery and you know how to deal with the complications. It's not just doing the surgery, it's how to deal with the complications when they occur. So what is happening now is our women, now I do infertility as well, and we're seeing more and more women with premature ovarian failure, and Sumbul was going to talk about it and didn't have time. This is a real issue that we're seeing, all of us as practicing gynecologists. More and more young women are coming with premature ovarian failure. So my first slide is, don't be a cowboy. There are virtually no men here, only 1 or 2, but cowgirls bhi hoti hain. Don't do things unnecessarily. Don't do ovarian drilling unnecessarily. As doctors, we promise we will first do no harm. The Hippocratic Oath is outdated. It's not relevant to current times. But most doctors don't know that. And we don't even take the oath when we graduate. And it's the same in US. Like 25% of doctors have never taken an oath. So it's, but we all have a code of conduct, of ethics. And we must not do procedures and must not prescribe drugs which are going to be harmful to our patients. So similarly, I'm just sharing with you the case of a 25-year-old married woman for 5 years, and she had had a laparoscopic ovarian drilling for PCO, very common. There was no semen analysis done preoperatively. She had a normal day 2 FSH pre-op, and when she presented to me, her FSH was more than 30. So this is criminal. And this was not done by a junior doctor or a recent FCPS. This was done by somebody very senior, and we've seen several cases like this done by seniors. So what can we say? We need to look at ourselves and look at what harm we're doing. So these are the causes of subfertility in females. Before any uterine instrumentation, we must do semen. Ideally, we should do a chlamydia screen, but unfortunately, it's not available here. So what do? We give prophylactic antibiotics to cover chlamydia as well. Which is the best test for tubal patency? We know the gold standard is laparoscopy and dye, and we're all itching to do it, but do a hysterosonogram or hysterosalpingogram when the patient doesn't have any comorbidities like PID, ectopic, history of ectopic or endometriosis. If you're expecting these as well, then it's better to do a laparoscopy, because you're not doing a laparoscopy just for the sake of diagnosis, you're also doing it to do some therapy as well. So if the tubes are blocked, you can do a salpingostomy and open them, and then she can get pregnant, and many do get pregnant. Sometimes even just with the pressure of your intubation, dihydrotubation, tubes open. And these days, more and more sonographers are doing the ultrasound contrast hysterosonography, which is even better because you get a real-time picture, you can see the spill, and you can see any polyps or any other things which may be present in the uterus, and it's cheaper and no radiation. And Dr. Musarat uses the mineral water, which is not even high QC, so it's even more cheaper. And more and his trained sonographers are using that, using mineral water, spring water, and that's quite safe. So you get a good outline of the cavity, any filling defects, cheap, but it's painful. So our patients do come back and say, oh, bahut dard hua tha doc saab, some even faint. So you must be ready to, you know, resuscitate a patient. These, hum bhej to dete hain, lekin unke saath bahut buri hoti hai. If you ask the woman, she will, doc saab, ye test maine nahi karwana, ye kaun sa test aapne hame keh diya tha. So, all the advantages and disadvantages, you know. And now, you know, like, if you are going to do a laparoscopy, or if you're suspecting some uterine pathology as well, it's a good idea to do hysteroscopy at the same time, and you get a very good view. You can see what you see here. It's not projecting well, but basically, this is an IUCD. And another thing over here is a polyp. These are multiple polyps at hysteroscopy. This is a uterine septum, quite a thick one. You can see the two cavities on both sides. In one on this side, these are the cavities, and this is a thick septum. So again, over here, there's a debate whether these septum, a uterine septum, should be divided or not. So there are two groups, and they don't agree with each other. And there's still no randomized controlled trials which have proven that one is better than the other. Those who do divide this septum hysteroscopically report better results, pregnancy rates, while the opposite camp says it makes no difference. So hysteroscopy should be offered as part of the initial investigation unless clinically indicated. The effectiveness of surgical treatment of uterine abnormalities on improving pregnancy rates has not been established, like I just told you. Surgeons intending to perform laparoscopic surgery should have appropriate training, supervision, and experience. Be familiar with the equipment, instrumentation, and energy sources, like you have a diathermy, unipolar, bipolar, you have the harmonic scalpel, you have laser. So all these things, what is the advantage, what is the disadvantage, the physics of it, as a surgeon you must understand all that and ensure that nursing staff and your surgical team is also appropriately trained. It's a whole teamwork, it's not just the surgeon who's doing it. So there are many advantages, you all know this, I will not go into it, and the disadvantages. So you must know both. And in our setup, we have to think about the cost. If I'm going to do a laparoscopic hysterectomy, is it going to work out cheaper for the patient or more expensive? Right? So even in a government setup, somebody is paying for that procedure. Who's that somebody? Not the patient, but who's that somebody? We the taxpayers. We're paying for that procedure. With our taxes is the health budget and the staff, everything. The hospital is being run with our money, right? So something that's going to cost like 50,000 rupees if you do it the standard way, you do a laparoscopic hysterectomy, wo 1.5 lakh rupees aapka bill ban raha hai. Surgeon ko aata nahi hai karna, aur wo aap sari gases istamal kar rahe hain, jo aadhe ghante ka operation hai, wo aap 6 ghante mein kar rahe hain. Theater time, all that. Think of it. So it becomes unethical. If you're doing that, that is wrong. Okay, it's not fair on the patient. She's under anesthesia for so long. You're just using her like a guinea pig then, isn't it? So whether you're doing it in the private sector or government, it's not fair. I did the first laparoscopic hysterectomy in Karachi in 1995. And I do very few, I don't do like hundreds, because I have to justify it. She wants to have it. So if she can afford it, then I will do it. But I always counsel them that if you have a transabdominal, conventional hysterectomy is going to be cheaper, and if she uses it, she's acceptable, then I'll do the laparoscopic. So that comes into everything. And these are the complications that you can run into. And anatomy. Samya said, one of the most common causes of failure in exams is the basics. And people scrub into surgery. I mean, yesterday I had a doctor with me and didn't know that what the round ligament was. Simple things. If you cannot identify living anatomy, you have no business performing surgery. When I was training, if I didn't know the anatomy, we got thrown out of the OT. Koi bezti nahi hoti thi, just leave, okay? You don't know the patient, you don't know the anatomy, what are you doing here? You have no business operating. So, डॉक्टर भी बन जाते हैं उनको पार्ट वन भी कर लिया स्टेप्स भी कर लिए और एनाटॉमी नहीं आती और आप सर्जरी कर रहे हैं नो आई एम सॉरी सो सिंपल थिंग्स लाइक यू आस्क देम व्हाई वी यूजिंग कार्बन डाइऑक्साइड इन लैप्रोस्कोपी एंड दे डोंट नो सो इट्स वेरी सिंपल यू नो यू कांट यूज ऑक्सीजन ऑक्सीजन कैन कंबस्ट कॉज अ बर्न एंड एवरीथिंग व्हाइल कार्बन डाइऑक्साइड वन ऑफ द मोस्ट फियर्ड कॉम्प्लिकेशंस The most feared is when you're making an entry, whether it's a Varis needle or with your trocar or whatever, if you enter not an artery, a vein, if you are entering a vein, it's a table death. Very few women will come out of that. You enter the vena cava, it's very easy. very easy when you're doing a laparoscopy, because that you will get air embolism, you've got gas under pressure, it's going to go straight to the heart. So these are very, very simple things, and when people, you ask these questions, you really should not be wanting to do these procedures without first knowing the theory about it. And not just the entry, it's the exit also, which is also very, very important. When you're exiting, if you've gone through and through a bowel, there's no way of knowing, and except when you're exiting. And very senior people have done this. It's not that you're junior, it's not that. Very senior people like Chris Sutton, who are the pioneers of laparoscopic surgery in UK, regularly used to show a video of him doing a laparoscopy on his daughter's friend, and when he's exiting, he showed how he had gone through the bowel and only picked up because he was looking at it through the camera when exiting. So patient selection, skills of the surgeons, your imaging systems should be excellent, clarity, maintenance, and if you can't see for any reason your picture is not good, abandon it and then do the conventional surgery, because you did decide to do it, remember? So this is a sign which I recently learned a few months back from a Japanese colleague, that if somebody's had previous surgery, you know, for instance, a hernia operation or any intra-abdominal surgery, she may have bowel adherent to the abdominal wall. So that is very scary, because you can easily, omentum ho sakta hai, but bowel is scary, small or large bowel. So one of the things you can do is, it's a simple non-invasive test to check for bowel adhesions. You put an ultrasound probe, okay, and tell the patient to breathe deeply, hold the breath, and then breathe out. So if the bowel is stuck to the umbilicus, it will not move, right? With the motion of inhaling and exhaling, the diaphragm moving up and down. If it's stuck, it will stay in that position. So it's there's no harm doing it, and I would suggest that you do it. This is what we see at normal laparoscopy. Normal ovaries and uterus. So we are used to looking at the pelvis, so it's not a big deal, but you do a systematic survey, look at the uterus, fimbria, ovaries, any evidence of PID, flip the ovaries and look underneath in the ovarian fossa, that's where you find endometriosis very commonly. And of course tubal patency, especially you're doing this for subfertility and endometriosis. You have to remember the laparoscope is basically a microscope giving you an enlarged view, so do a whole survey. I usually start from the top under the diaphragm, and I'm picking up so many chlamydia infections, you know, those typical Fitzhugh-Curtis syndrome, you see that, and I'm seeing so much of tuberculosis now. It's so worrisome. We have a tuberculosis coming back in a big way. And you have to look at the whole of the peritoneum, the bowel surface, and in the end I come to the pelvis. So you describe every, you do a whole laparoscopy, means you look at everything you can see. You can see gallbladder, liver surface, everything. So this is a patient of mine with Fitzhugh-Curtis syndrome, primary infertility, no history of any surgery. So that this top bit is the under surface of the diaphragm, it's very magnified, so you can see this hole like a curtain, it's going down onto the liver surface. In operative laparoscopy, we were talking diagnostic first. In operative endometriosis, you can operate on that, excise the endometriotic lesions if she's got pain, adhesiolysis, sapingostomy, salpingectomy, ovarian drilling, caution, and myomectomy, of course, but the enthusiasm for myomectomy is going down. So polycystic ovaries may appear quite normal on ultrasound, as well as laparoscopy, yet the woman may have metabolic syndrome, so please remember that. if you have to do ovarian drilling, like you've tried everything and the ovaries were resistant, so you can do it, but only 3 to 4 holes. So these are the risks for surgery as well: ovarian failure, adhesions, injury to bowel and other organs, as well as risk for GA. This is a picture of endometriosis deep in the pouch of Douglas. This is so deep, I'm right down to the vault. This is where I found it, or kahin beneath. These are kissing ovaries. They're both stuck to each other, as you can see. And usko further push karne pe ye andar se ye blood or ye endometriosis became apparent. The pouch of Douglas is totally obliterated. These are all bad situations. When you go in, you may not see anything, but when you go in and go closer and expose each and every portion, now this is at the ovarian fossa, you can see the endometriosis there after flipping the ovary. This is a friend's daughter who had a ruptured both sides, bilateral ruptured chocolate cysts. She presented with severe pain, and even the undersurface of diaphragm was covered with endometriosis. So poor thing, she was in so much pain. Now endometriosis, especially in we see them in young women, subfertile women. Medical treatment of minimal and mild endometriosis does not enhance fertility. In minimal or mild endometriosis, surgical ablation or resection plus laparoscopic adhesolysis improves the chance of pregnancy. Laparoscopic cystectomy improves the chance of pregnancy.
3 minutes.
Okay. All right. So I'll skip this, but basically the bottom line is, do not operate on endometriosis unnecessarily. She may have cysts, but they may be big also, even bigger than 5 centimeters sometimes. But if she is asymptomatic, do resist the temptation in young women. I'm not talking about older women. I'm sure Alia will talk about it as well, because endometriosis is a risk for ovarian cancer as well. But in younger women, when we are trying to preserve fertility, do not go in and operate if you are sure you're dealing with endometriosis and not anything else. Right? So, hydrosalpinx is another thing you can operate on and open, and it should actually be either they should be removed before IVF, you can do it laparoscopically, or alternatively, sometimes it's just not possible to remove them because of adhesions and you might end up doing more damage, you can clip the tubes. The idea is that we should not be communicating with the uterine cavity. This is a salpingostomy which has been done with pressure hydrotubation. I'll skip the fibroids. So, these are some pictures of abdominal tuberculosis, recent cases that I've done. You can see the caseating granulomas. Again, these women give no history of TB, and that is the alarming thing. When I came, exhausted the options and found next step is laparoscopy. If I hadn't done it, we wouldn't know that she had tuberculosis. And several of them have had anti-TB, this is the undersurface of diaphragm, with tuberculous changes. And look at this horrible omentum. This is the pelvis. These are all different pictures, different patients, and none of them look the same. That is the worrisome thing about tuberculosis, that you cannot present a classical picture. And this was the undersurface of diaphragm in another patient. So I'm going to, end here. This is an ectopic, unruptured ectopic pregnancy, which can be easily missed if you're not looking for it. You look at the size of the ectopic here. This is in front of the ovary, so it's even smaller than the ovary actually. Right? So you have to have a trained eye to pick that up. Tubal reanastomosis can be done somebody who's had a previous tubal ligation and remarries, wants to have another baby, you can do that, and with good results. More than 90% get pregnant, so don't give up on them. So please remember, when you're dealing with a subfertile woman, the biological clock is ticking with every failed attempt for conception every month. At 35 years, one in four pregnancies result in miscarriage. And at 40 years, more than 77% of the oocytes are aneuploid, meaning only one out of five eggs is normal. So chances of conception of a normal pregnancy really go down drastically. So do not hold on to these women and keep giving them Clomid. Do refer them at the right time to the right center. Thank you very much. And this slide, it's a favorite slide of mine, Papuyar Jannagar. And I talked about taxes, and I think Indus is showing what good work you can do with little money. It goes a long way. So our government needs to divert its funds away from war and towards education and health, and hum sab theek ho jayenge. And last but not the least, we have our SOGP conference next month here in Karachi in PC, and we hope to see all of you there, inshallah. Thank you.
Premature ovarian failure can occur as a result of the drilling of PCO. But what I want to say is, please give a lot of respect to the ovaries, like you are operating. Sorry, you have to carry it. Okay. No, that's not a problem. I think when you are dealing with the endometriotic cells, it's a big, huge capsule there. Usually, what I used to see at one time, the most of the capsule was removed, it was denuded. It has got a lot of suppressed follicles. Try not to damage the ovary when you are operating on the ovary, whether it is for endometriosis and we are doing the enucleation of the cells. Try to conserve as much part of the ovary as possible, especially by removing the benign cyst and also the endometriotic cyst. I think do peel off the endometriotic cyst, no doubt, but damage as little ovary as possible. Thank you. Just one.
Dr. Fadia ne abhi bataya ki tuberculosis ka ek resurgence hai. That is what I am experiencing at the Indus Hospital. और मैंने मैं ये समझती हूँ कि हर जो औरत आती है for the treatment of subfertility, एक question जो उसकी history में add हो जाना चाहिए, वो ये है कि if there is history of TB in the past, treated, untreated or uncontact, contact की history is very common. And because Indus is also running a TB screening and treatment program, so we have picked up cases on the basis of these two simple questions who turned out to be tuberculosis later. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sadia Sani, for such an informative presentation. Our last topic for the day is ovarian cancer. How should we individualize surgical management? And this talk will be conducted by Dr. Arya Aziz, Associate Professor of Gynae in Aga Khan Hospital. She is formerly trained gynecological oncologist from UK and director of fellowship program in the gynae oncology. I would request Dr. Arya to please come on the stage and present.
Introduction.
I'd like to thank Dr. Samia, Dr. Aisha for giving me this opportunity to be here and give you this presentation. When they asked me to talk about some cancer, and I thought this is something after breast in Pakistan, the most common gynecological cancer, and I thought I'm limited because it will benefit most of us, because we, most of my colleagues and trainees see this kind of cancer more commonly, and they have to deal with it. Because of the limited time, I will be constraining my talk to only epithelial ovarian cancer. I can't talk about everything. I do not have any conflict of interest. Today I'm going to talk about a little bit about historical perspective, surgery for early stage disease, fertility preservation in these patients, surgery for advanced stage, and in the end I will summarize. So historical perspective, the first oophorectomy was done on Christmas Eve in 1809 by Ephraim McDowell. After about 70 years of this first oophorectomy, Sir Thomas Spencer Wells published his first series of 500 ovariotomies, specifically for ovarian cancer. Of course, at that time it was a procedure with significant morbidity and mortality. And he was the first who referred this famous quote from him, and he referred to staging in ovarian cancer. And if you read this quote, surgeons stood and trembled on the brink of ovarian water. And what he meant by ascites and the reference of ascites as an important predictor in staging. It was Make who first championed the ovarian debulking surgery in 1934. And after almost 40 years after the Make did debulking surgeries, Griffith published the first landmark study which showed the inverse relationship between the residual tumor and the survival. So he showed that if you leave as little disease behind as possible, you actually increase the survival. So the most important topic for the young patients and for early ovarian cancer patients is how do we go about doing comprehensive surgical staging? And I think this is very important, and it's very close to my heart, because we get a lot of patients who have been inadequately staged, and sometimes you have to do restaging, sometimes you have to give them chemotherapy unnecessarily, and that's why I wanted to talk about this. Adequate surgical staging is very important according to FIGO guidelines. And what do we mean by adequate staging? We have to do a longitudinal laparotomy. So you can't do a laparotomy for ovarian cancer with a fenestial incision. So many a times when patients come for opinion and we look at the incision and then we realize, oh, it cannot have been an adequate staging. So it has to be a midline incision which can be extended if needed. You have to take cytology, and I'll come to this point a little later. Total abdominal hysterectomy, bilateral saphenophorectomy, omentectomy, which should be total omentectomy, peritoneal biopsies, pelvic and periaortic lymphadenectomy. And the most crucial thing is prevention of rupture. It is very important. You as trainees, we have lots of junior colleagues. We have to be very careful about how to handle these tumors. We have to be careful not to cause any intraoperative rupture, because you are going to upstage the disease. It's not very clear, but this slide is to show that how important it is to identify stage 1C cancer. And I'm sure all the trainees are aware of the FIGO staging, in which 1C is now further divided into 1C1, 1C2, and 1C3. And these are tumor cells which are floating in the peritoneal fluid. And if you don't take cytology at the start of surgery, you are going to miss them. And if you miss them, then even if we are doing a restaging, you can't. You are going to miss that stage. And of course, if you have missed 1C, you might have missed a very important prognostic marker, and you might be giving them unnecessary chemotherapy, or you might be omitting chemotherapy when it is needed. So that's why my plea would be, please take cytology before you start surgery, before you touch the mass, in all cases, in all suspected cases. In all suspected or complex masses, take cytology. And even if you later don't want to send it, or if you are in a public sector hospital where it will increase, if in your opinion it will increase the expenses, later on after the frozen section or everything, you can omit it. But take it. Take it from when you start the surgery. The second important thing is stage 3 cancer. Stage 3 cancer is when you have disease not only in the pelvis but also in the abdomen, right? So when you have disease in the abdomen, it can be either intraperitoneal disease or retroperitoneal disease. So you might have disease in the lymph nodes. And if you don't sample the lymph nodes, you might miss actual stage 3C disease, and you might deny a patient the benefit of combination chemotherapy, and of course it will affect survival. And to stress on this point, I will show you the most important trial which has been done, the ACTION trial, in which after surgery patients were randomized, and all these patients were early stage epithelial carcinoma. After surgery they were randomized into two arms. One arm was chemotherapy and second was observation arm. And they were only given chemotherapy if they developed recurrence. Now what was the 5-year survival? If you look at in this arm, although it was a trial in which everybody was supposed to be adequately staged, but half of them were not adequately staged. So if you see the first two bars, these are the patients in whom adequate staging was done. And if you look at the 5-year survival, it was not different between the chemotherapy arm and the observation arm, right? On the other hand, the second two bars are the patients who had not been adequately staged. And if you see the observation arm, this they do have significantly decreased 5-year survival, right? People concluded that, okay, if somebody has not had adequate staging, then okay, give them chemotherapy. It's not so easy. When you talk about chemotherapy, you talk about a drug with significant side effects, and probably we could have avoided it if we would have done adequate staging. So doing adequate staging is a surrogate of survival, not giving chemotherapy to everybody. So what are the benefits of comprehensive staging? It results in better selection of post-operative adjuvant chemotherapy. We may avoid chemotherapy in FECO stage 1A G1, the well-differentiated tumor. We may avoid toxicity of combination chemotherapy in true FECO 1A G2 to 2A. And it can identify patients who are in need for combination chemotherapy. That is the true FECO stage 3C. And restaging after inadequate surgery should be considered. So if you get a patient who has been not adequately staged, cytology was not taken, the other omentectomy was not done, lymph nodes were not sampled, and she comes to you, especially if she's young and it's an early stage disease, do not give them chemotherapy right away. Do an adequate staging, and then if required, you can offer them chemotherapy. So how do I manage a young woman desirous of future childbearing? Now, I'm amazed, over a period of years, we do see 25-year-old, 24-year-old, even 20-year-old suffering from ovarian cancer. So this question is very close to my heart, what to do? I mean, they are still in childbearing age and we don't want to deny them. So what do we do? What do we mean by that? Preservation of at least part of the ovary and uterus in patients with early stages. So there are some requirements. If somebody says that I want to have a fertility preservation, then we have to say that it can be proposed only for women of childbearing age. So you can't do fertility preservation at the age of 45. Patients should be informed about both oncological and obstetrical outcomes. And we'll come to what we are talking about. It can only be offered in case of early stage disease after adequate staging. So if the patient has not had adequate staging, you can't offer them fertility preservation. Patients should agree to comply with the thorough follow-up. This is very important. You can't do them if they are living, if they are coming from Chitral and Gilgit, and they are going to be lost for follow-up. Mm-hmm. And a histological review by an expert pathologist should always be done. So what we do is, if somebody comes asking for opinion, we always ask them to get us the blocks and get it reviewed by an expert gynae pathologist, and that helps us in decision. Now, what we know or what has come in the guidelines is that early stage disease, 1A involving 1 OB, grade 1 and 2, and stage 1C, grade 1, oncological outcomes are similar in both conservative versus conventional arm. What I mean by conservative is when we do fertility preservation. So these groups are, we don't have any uncertainties. but there are certain uncertainties in grade 3 disease, in 1C, 1, 2, 3, in stage 2 to 3, or in clear cell tumors. So we will be discussing those. There is a very recent review, a literature review of all fertility preserving surgeries done, recently published, and the results reveal that if you look at stage 1A, grade 1 and 2, the recurrences are 7 or 11 over here as well. But if you look at grade 3, the recurrence rate is 29% and 23%, so it's significantly higher. So if somebody comes who has got a grade 3 disease, you have to tell them that the recurrence rate is quite high. Also, these recurrences are extra-ovarian mostly, and extra-ovarian are more lethal. They are difficult to treat, so that's why you have to be very careful about fertility preservation in these patients. So the recurrences are more common in extra-ovarian, and so the preservation of one ovary is probably not the cause of recurrence in these patients. So extra-ovarian relapses could be because of the natural history of grade 3 disease. So even in grade 3, if the patient has good compliance with follow-ups, then you can do it because you know that they are desirous and you can follow them up closely. Then we come to stage 1C. As I said, stage 1C is divided into three. 1C1, when there is an intraoperative rupture of the capsule. Stage 1C2, when it is a preoperative rupture. And stage 1C3, when they are malignant cells in the ascites or in the cytology. So these three have got different implications. So if you have 1C1 tumors, in which happens with most of us, that you have a difficult tumor, lots of adhesions, and it ruptures, right? So if it is ruptured in front of you and it becomes as 1C1, the oncological, the recurrence rate is accepted, still acceptable, then you can do fertility preservation. But if you are talking about 1C2 and 1C3, the recurrence rate is higher. So that's how it is important. And it is unclear whether it is because of natural history of disease. Then we come to the histotypes. This is a very recent study still in press, and you can see the mucinous tumors are very common. And it's not surprising because mucinous tumors are usually unilateral and seen in very early stage disease. So patients who are desirous for fertility will have lots of mucinous tumors. And the recurrence rate is higher in serous and clear cells. So still, mucinous tumors can be offered, women with mucinous tumors can be offered fertility preservation. Then we come to clear cell. Clear cell historically is considered as high grade. When we hear the word clear cell, we say, oh, it's a buri khabar. Oh, it's a clear cell. But you will be surprised that the recurrence rate of 17% is oncologically acceptable in very early stage clear cell even. And there have been studies from Asian countries where they have similar survival or oncological outcomes between conservative as well as radical surgeries in clear cell. And they have, in the recent ESGO guidelines, they have proposed that there is something weird and something good, and maybe it's biologically not that aggressive in Asian countries. So we belong to an Asian country, and even in clear cell, we don't have to really struggle and worry, and we can offer fertility. So when we are talking about fertility sparing, it should be a multidisciplinary management, should go through a tumor board, there should be a histological review, and there should be an adequate surgical staging. Now, conclusion, safety has been proven for early stages, even in 1C1, grade 1 and 2, questionable in grade 3 and 1C2 and 1C3, clear cell in Asia is okay, contraindicated in stage 2 and 3, and clear cell in other countries. Now we come to, the pictures are not coming very good, the resolutions are not very good, but it shows a very advanced stage disease. How long do you think, and my question to the audience, how long do you think this woman can survive after surgery? How many people think 1 year? Raise your hands. There are 2 people. How many think 2 years? How many think 5 years? Very few people are raising their hand as if they are uncertain, because I think it's not a true reflection of what the field. But this is what I'm going to take you through, that even this kind of tumor, if adequately treated, that means if it undergoes an adequate surgery, can survive for 6 to 7 years, right? And why? Because when you look at the survival variables, some variables are, they belong to patient, age and medical comorbidity. Tumor biology, stage, tumor biology and response to chemo is another survival variable. What we are interested as surgeons is the surgeon's strategy, and that is the residual disease. If the surgeon is experienced, if they do have expertise, resources, and are working in an institution where they are doing more than 100 debulking surgeries in a year, this patient has got a good chance of survival for 5 to 6 years. This is to show you that if you do this kind of surgery, and if you have no residual tumor, and you can compare this with somebody with some residual disease, you get the advantage of 5 years in FIGO 2B to 3B, you get the advantage of 4 years in FIGO 3C. So this is advantage over the survival which you are going to get anyway. And that's what I'm trying to raise the point, that a good surgery is going to help these patients. So a more individualized approach has to be considered. When you get a patient, you have to ascertain by some way if the disease is resectable. If this disease is resectable and the patient do not have comorbid, you can go for upfront debulking surgery. But if the patient, if the tumor extent is not compatible with primary debulking surgery, if the patient is not fit for upfront debulking, then you can give them neoadjuvant chemotherapy or palliative chemotherapy and then do an interval debulking. So how can we predict resectability? I mean, we all come across such patients, and patients come with abdominal distension, they have massive ascites, they have abdominal masses, peritoneal carcinomatosis. So how can we ascertain that we can actually resect it, right? So there are three ways of doing it. One is by identification of key sites of unresectability. One is by assessment of tumor load. And option three is by developing some kind of a scoring system. Now, if you see this, this is a phase 3 randomized trial, and they have identified that almost 90% of unresectable disease is because of small bowel carcinomatosis and hepatic hilar disease. So if we can somehow identify this disease, we know that this will be in this optimal debulking would probably be not possible. So how can we ascertain resectability? We have all these tools, CT, PET-CT, ultrasound, diffusion rated MRI, and laparoscopy, where Dr. Sargon's skill is. Now, if you look at CT, we all get CT done for somebody coming with complex mass. What are we trying to look at? We are trying to look at the regions which we feel are key sites of unresectability. If we find disease at these key sites, we somehow get the idea that probably she's not a good candidate for upfront debulking. On those key sites are small bowel, as we just said, small bowel involvement and hepatic hilar involvement. CT scan is not very sensitive for this. It has got a low sensitivity. There is also a problem of spatial resolution. CT scan cannot identify small nodules less than 5 millimeters. So you might get surprises because you see CT scan, it's resectable. You open it up and you see lots of small nodules which were missed by CT. So that's the problem with CT. When you go for FDG PET is also not very sensitive. Again, the problem of spatial resolution is there. I'll show you this example. Again, it's not coming very good, but you can see that this was the bright signal coming in an adnexal mass on an FDG PET. And on FDG PET, that was the only thing shining. So we thought, oh, it is a localized disease and we can do it. But when we opened it up, there was disease involving omentum up to spleen. Spleen was involved. We had diaphragmatic disease. We had disease in the pouch of Douglas. So this is just to show you how ineffective FDG PET was in this particular instance. Then you come to laparoscopy. Laparoscopy has been proposed as to assess resectability, and people have done lots of studies in which they say that before doing primary debulking, assess it through a laparoscope. And this is the most recent study in which it was a randomized trial, and they have quoted a futile laparotomy, and they call futile laparotomy as a laparotomy in which a complete debulking or optimal debulking is not possible. So this shows how important it is to do a laparoscopy if possible, and people have done cost-effective analysis as well, and they have said that it will not bankrupt you. In fact, it will save you, because you are not doing laparotomy, or you are not doing FDG PET or some kind of expensive imaging. You are just doing a laparoscopy, and based on this laparoscopy scoring, you can identify the disease, which is unresectable. Then we come to the second point. How can you assess tumor load? The tumor load can be assessed by either imaging or by laparoscopy, and there is scoring that if you have disease in which there is no carcinomatosis, no bulky upper abdominal disease, considered as zero score, and you can see that the optimal debulking rate is higher if you have a less tumor load. So this is how indirectly you can identify. The third is, can we have a scoring system? Scoring system means you combine some technical things with some clinical features, and this will give you a best risk-benefit ratio. And if you look at, I just put one, the most recent one, in which age more than 60 years, liver 25 more than 600, and ASA scoring, along with some imaging criteria is used to score. And based on this score, you can identify whether you will be able to resect or not. So achieving maximum cytoreduction in advanced stage is a systemic and meticulous exercise, and it's not a haphazard act. I remember I attended a conference in Los Angeles, and Dennis Chi, who's the pioneer of optimal debulking in Memorial Sloan, he said that when he started doing these kind of surgeries in which we have to do peritonectomy, splenectomy, bowel resections, anastomosis, and all the things possible to remove the tumor bulk as much as possible, they used to call it, his operating day was Friday, and people used to call him, oh, he is coming to do Dennis Chiectomy, because he used to take hours. And then the patients used to go on a weekend into the ICU, and the ICU people used to be flustered about it. But his results have shown the improved survival, which I showed you earlier. And I faced the same thing. My fellow graduated from Aga Khan last month. She went to Ahmedabad, and she faced the same problem when she tried to do the first oncology surgery, and she faced this resistance, and people said, how can you do this surgery? You said it's going to take 5 hours. Then when are we going to do our elective list? And she said, it took me a long time to make them understand that this patient is admitted, a 77-year-old, admitted for 14 days with a huge mass, suspected of cancer, and nobody was operating on her, just because they have to do a routine cerclages, routine hysterectomies. So she had to fight to do the first oncology surgery in Ahmedabad Teaching Hospital. She did it. Patient went home. Alhamdulillah, patient is well and recovered. But I'm trying to tell you that if you do these kind of surgeries, it takes time. It takes time, and it needs that kind of jazba. You can't do it if you don't have jazba. If I have to do 6 cases on a list, I might not have that jazba. So if I want to benefit somebody, I need to have that jazba. Okay, I'll do 1 case. It might take me 5 to 6 hours, but I'll do it this way. And this is how the patients are going to be helped, not otherwise. So to summarize, comprehensive staging is mandatory in presumably early stage cancer. Overwhelmingly, data supports that lower visible disease prior to chemotherapy results in longest overall survival. The goal of cytoreduction should be zero residual. The timing of this procedure, either primary or interval debulking, plays its role. Prediction of surgical outcome is currently one of the main issues in advanced ovarian cancer. Scoring systems, including tumor and patient characteristics, may assist clinicians when difficult decisions need to be undertaken. Neoadjuvant chemotherapy can be considered in selected patients in advanced stages because of lower morbidity and similar survival. Patients suspected should be operated wherever possible by a gynecologist in the teaching hospital. I was writing this line and I thought people will say, oh, she's trying to project herself. I'm not projecting myself. I'm trying to say I want to train as many as possible so that in each area, in each region of Pakistan, we have at least one trained gynecologist to take my mission through. Achieving successful outcome require a team effort and expert multidisciplinary perioperative team. Thank you.
With this, we will coming to the end of our session. We have 5 minutes for question and answers.
If there are any questions, they are welcome. Main, Dr. Arya, आपको मैंने जिस मोहब्बत से शौक है बुलाया था, मुझे लगता है कि मेरी मोहब्बत justified थी, because मैं भी इस profession में काफी सालों से हूँ. मेरा एक्सपीरियंस आलिया के एक्सपीरियंस को कहीं भी मैच नहीं करता. मैंने जो ओवर द ईयर्स एक्सचेंज देखा है कि वी आर इनकाउंटरिंग मोर ओवेरियन कैंसर्स एज कम्पेयर टू प्रीवियस ईयर्स. सो जब मैंने ये चीज़ इंडस में देखी, जेपीएमसी में भी देखा था, बहुत इंडस में भी देखा, तो अगेन कमिंग टू द पॉइंट, मैं समझती हूँ कि अगर मैं अपने लिए एक एक्सेलेंट सर्जरी चाहूँ, इफ आई एम विक्टिम टू अ डिजीज, तो आई वॉन्ट द बेस्ट ट्रीटमेंट फॉर माई सेल्फ. सो वी नीड टू थिंक अबाउट दिस, आर वी ऑफरिंग द बेस्ट ऑफ आर सेल्फ टू आर पेशेंट्स. सो ऑन्कोलॉजी बींग अ वेरी वेरी सेंसिटिव एरिया, तो मेरा तो दिल चाहता है मैं आलिया की स्टूडेंट बन जाऊँ. दिस इज नॉट अ जोक, दिस इज रियली अ विश दैट आई एम कैरिंग अलॉन्ग. मैं स्टेज में कर सकती हूँ, नहीं कर सकती, लेकिन मैं आलिया से एक रिक्वेस्ट जरूर करती हूँ कि शी बींग द लीडिंग गायनी ऑन्कोलॉजिस्ट, प्लीज डिवाइस एंड प्लान सम स्ट्रेटजी जिसमें आपकी ये सर्विस हमारे जो अंडर प्रिविलेज क्लास है उस तक पहुँचे. और वी ऑल शुड ट्राई टू अवॉइड सब ऑप्टिमल सर्जरीज. सो मेरे जो क्वेश्चंस थे बहुत हद तक एड्रेस हो गए आलिया की प्रेजेंटेशन से. अनडिसेक्टेबिलिटी को हमें कैसे असेस करना है, आगे बढ़ना है, नहीं बढ़ना है, लेप्रोस्कोपी करनी है. सो आई थिंक आई हैव बेनिफिटेड अ लॉट फ्रॉम दिस टॉक. आई एम श्योर एवरीवन एल्स मस्ट.
Thank you, Alia, and your lectures are always excellent. I just want to add an information which most people don't know about fertility preservation, like primal preservation in concept fertility. And this is a real dilemma, and especially in young girls who are not even married, and you saved an ovary and then she may be needing chemotherapy as well. Huh? So this is an option you can give, that we only recently have this. Because sperms to freeze karna asaan hota hai, they are small cells, the egg freezing takes a lot of technology, vitrification. Frozen embryo to asaan hai, because those cells, small compact cells hote hain, and sperms bhi freeze to kamshari karne, but egg freezing is more of it, and then their survival and jab unko thaw kiya jata hai. But in any case, you know, she hasn't got anything to lose. If she's not going to lose, and if she's able to afford, give this answer. Basically, you take them through a hyperstimulation cycle, and you pick up as many eggs as you can before she goes on. So just because you deal with such patients, and there are many of us who, we are asked this question. So just thought I'd let you know, maybe in Pakistan.
Anyone from the audience for questions?
आपकी प्रेजेंटेशन माशाल्लाह बहुत अच्छी है. आई एम ब्रिगेडियर प्रबंधा आस्किंग यू फ्यू क्वेश्चंस. वन इज व्हेन वी आर गोइंग फॉर सर्जरी, इज इट पॉसिबल फॉर अस टू गिव सम साइटोटॉक्सिक थेरेपी बिफोर द प्रोसीजर टू अवॉइड स्प्लिट ऑफ द कैंसर सेल्स इन द कैविटी ड्यूरिंग ऑपरेशन. एंड माय सेकंड क्वेश्चन इज, when we are performing these surgeries, is it possible to do this staging during operation, because we are doing it previously. Is there any role of doing the procedure intraoperatively?
Mm-hmm.
thank you for asking such good questions. In the answer of first question, if you are doing, I think what you are trying to ask is about intraperitoneal chemotherapy. So if you already have the diagnosis and if you are doing surgery, then yes, there is a role of intraperitoneal chemotherapy. Unfortunately, we are not practicing it because we don't have that high-pack machine and everything available. Otherwise, it is now almost becoming a standard to use hypothermic intraperitoneal chemotherapy at the time of surgery. So once you have debulked, then you put some cytotoxic agent into the tummy, leave it for 1 or 2 hours, and then take it out and close it. So that's one thing. The second question was not very clear. You said that can we do staging when we are doing surgery?
Yes.
So yes, I think you are doing the right thing, because what doctor is saying is that can we do frozen section, and based on frozen section decide about in whom we can do fertility preservation or not. Yes, if you have a very good frozen section service, you might get that kind of information which will help you right away. So sometimes we get patients who have ovarian cystectomy done, and then later on it is discovered to have either early epithelial cancer or a borderline cancer, right? If you have a frozen section which tells you that it is borderline, then you can do at least unilateral oophorectomy and serpingectomy and leave the other ovary behind if it is grossly healthy. So yes, this kind of frozen section based surgical staging with fertility preservation is very good, and we all should practice it.
Including remarks.
Well, I'm thankful to Dr. Thara, Dr. Samia, and Dr. Aisha for inviting me to be here. I'm not surprised at all by the work that she has done, because I remember the zeal and the enthusiasm. I saw her when she was working at the civil hospital. She used to stand in the corridor and dealing with paramedics and dealing with the attendants. It is difficult to work the way she used to work at an institute like civil hospital, with so many pressures, not only of the patient, but so many political pressures. I'm sure Dr. Mabel is a witness to it. That's how Dr. Farah used to deal with all sort of strange situations arising at civil hospital. So I congratulate her for the work that she has been doing here, but certainly I'm not surprised about it. Coming back to the presentations, I don't know how to qualify. Each presentation was so complete and so comprehensive. Starting with Dr. Samia's presentation, my goodness, she has touched the heart of so many postgraduates. And you have actually said something very practical. This is that the basic is important. The knowledge of the basics actually helps you all the way around in your post-graduation, plus in your teaching and in your career. Similarly, you have said very rightly, it is the quality that is important. It's not the number of cesarean sections, it's the quality of cesarean sections that our doctors are doing. And again, I mean, there is no credit given. It is not respect the tissue care. Be gentle to the tissue. Take your time, especially when you are in your learning stage, in your early career. Give time and improve the quality, that is important. And then Dr. Sumbul has said so much about menopause. Urdu mein kehte hai ki darya ko kooze mein baandh diya. So that is what you have actually done. We have covered all the aspects of menopause. And you have talked about sequential hormone therapy. I think this is very important in premature menopause. premature menopause is something which is which has become very common even in unmarried girls. Even in unmarried girls in their late 20s and early 30s, we see premature menopause, and it is irrespective of the social class, because we have seen it in civil hospital, in my own hospital, and even at South City. So it is such sort of hormone therapy that we have mentioned, it is something that has actually that will be very helpful, and psychologically it will give them a boost. I am having a period just like anybody else. And then of course, as I said, that you have done such a beautiful overview of covering all the aspects of menopause. Again, the hypovitaminosis is something that is very common in our society, irrespective of social class, and you have mentioned about the role of calcium and vitamin D. So HRT is not the first and the last treatment of menopause, but there are certain other measures also that can be tried. And then Dr. Sadia's presentation, she has covered the role of endoscopy in gynecology, in infertility basically, and also in gynecology. Dr. Sadia has mentioned about the role of hysterosalpingogram. There is no doubt about the role of hysterosalpingogram. For the patency, as far as the patency of the fallopian tube is concerned, there is no doubt about it, but at the same time, we also need to remember the role of laparoscopy in procedures like to begin in infertility, starting from dye test and a diagnostic procedure, going up to the enucleation of endometriotic cysts leading to pregnancies, and then that breakdown of the adhesion. So Dr. Saab has given a very comprehensive talk about the role of endoscopy, and she has very rightly talked about the hysteroscopy. As far as the hysteroscopy is concerned, its role is no doubt limited, but when it comes to congenital anomalies, either of minor septae of the inside the uterus or when it comes to polyp, yes, there is certain role of hysteroscopy in patients coming to us with subfertility. And then again, yes, ovarian drilling should not be the first line treatment. It should be the treatment only for the resistant cases of polycystic ovaries. And the rule is very simple: 4 punctures, 4 millimeter deep, 4 ampere current. With this, the risk of ovarian failure is less as compared to doing very enthusiastic work rather burning the ovary instead of drilling. If you end up burning the ovary, then of course you will have a young patient coming to you with ovarian failure. Coming to Dr. Alia's presentation, a topic so close to my heart. Dr. Alia, you have such a nicely presented individualization of treatment. I mean, hats off for it. The way you have talked about the preservation of subfertility in patients with ovarian cancer, you have said very rightly that it's becoming common nowadays to get young girls in their 20s and girls who are desirous to have retained their fertility. Although we do have so many problems when it comes to fertility after the treatment of ovarian malignancy in our society, but yes, you have said it so nicely. It's beautiful. It's a beautiful presentation. The presentation you have given, it's a beautiful presentation. And then you have said very rightly that accurate staging is very important, and individualization of patient is of course important. When we are deciding to preserve fertility, you are very right that we should do something very important is the compliance of the patient. If the patient doesn't come up for follow-up, then how are you going to know? And then again, she may come back to you, she's not coming for follow-up, she may come back to you with the recurrence of the disease. So compliance on the hand of the patient is something very important. Another important thing that you have mentioned is the mucinous, the increasing prevalence of mucinous tumor, which is certainly good to know that it is less to recur, less likely to recur. And of course, adequate, there is no second thought as far as the adequate debulking at the time of primary surgery is concerned. There is no second thought about it. And then again, when we are talking of individualization of care, just like in the last lecture of preliminary session, they were talking about it, the care being given to the patient or the individualization care of the patient. So when we are talking of ovarian treatment of ovarian malignancy, surgery and chemotherapy is, general chemotherapy is not the end of it. Nowadays, the work is going on protein inhibitors, on endometrial growth factor inhibitors, on angiokinases and folate antagonists. So we hope that we may not be able to see it in near future, but sometime in our country also we will be able to identify that which drug should be given instead of just giving a random chemotherapy, which drug we should be able to target and give it to our patient. Dr. Alia has mentioned that also, and I think probably in future we will be able to do that. I thank you once again for the organizers and for the speakers for their such a learned and valuable talks. Thank you very much.
And for memento distribution to our joining guests.
उनको बोलो साधु जी
ओके
यस लुक हियर मैम प्लीज थैंक यू
एंड नाउ आई विल रिक्वेस्ट डॉक्टर सुंदर सुहेल टू प्लीज कम
Yes, look here, please. Excuse me, Sadhu Ji, please. Ma'am, please look here. Smell me. Thank you.
And now I will request Dr. Alia Begumati to please come back.
Yes, look here, please. Excuse me, ma'am. Ma'am, yahan dekhiyega, please. Thank you.
चार दिन के करूँ आपके बाद मेरे में क्या करूँ
तो आप
मेरे में सही है ना बस सही आप बोलो क्या आप क्या बोलो इसको वो नहीं देखेंगे Okay, look at the camera.
Oh my God. Then?
They cut me in a few.
So I thank everybody, the chairperson, Professor Aisha Khan, all the speakers, and all the participants who have made this session successful. And I must also acknowledge the sponsors behind this session and the management and the scientific committee who gave us the forum to carry this session. Thank you everybody and Allah Hafiz, and you can proceed for lunch now.
All of you.
Okay, yeah. Wait, kijiyega. Chalo pucho.
Kaise dekhiyega sir?
आप लोग भी ज्वाइन कर लेना आप लोग
घर के लोग भाई
जाएगा आओ
वेट कीजिएगा
हो गया डैन डैन
वेट 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 वेट
वेट भाई इसका लैम नहीं है